Welcome back, everyone. I'm Allison Berman. Right now, I'm sitting here with Mihir Garimella. He is the winner of Google's Science Fair, which has some 10 to 15,000 entries. He's creating a search and response drone for emergency situations, and it is absolutely incredible. Welcome.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
So tell me about the drone that you're creating.
Sure, yeah. So this is my latest prototype. And basically the idea is that we can send these drones into really dangerous environments. So you can think of like a burning building during a fire, or a building that's damaged in an earthquake, or even like a large factory with a gas leak. Mm-hmm. And the robot would use some sensors on board to like find things. So it could find a person who's trapped, or it could find the source of the fire, or where the gas leak is. Mm-hmm. And so this is really important for three basic reasons, right? So the first is that it prevents first responders from having to go into this environment and risk their own lives.
Definitely.
Right? And so like in a burning building, right? Obviously, if we can prevent firefighters from having to go in and spend a lot of time there, that's really useful. And the second thing is that by adding some, you know, intelligent sensors and some cool algorithms to these, we can actually make them faster than first responders, right?
Wow.
And so, you know, and just based also based on the fact that they can, they're really tiny, they can fly fast,
mm-hmm.
right? And so we can carry out a search and rescue mission in, you know, potentially 1 to 2 minutes mm-hmm. rather than half an hour.
Faster, keeping humans out of dangerous situations.
Yeah. And then the third thing is that we're trying to make them really cheap.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, existing flying robots, especially ones that have any degree of autonomy, cost like tens of thousands of dollars.
Right.
And so trying to get this into the, you know, $250 to $500 price range. And so that's really useful for developing countries where, mm-hmm. you know, they could benefit from these a lot.
Yeah.
And then also as we try to use these robots in swarms, right? So the cheaper they are, the more we can have.
And when you say swarms, would that be like with this smaller one and a fleet of them going out searching?
For sure, yeah, yeah. So swarms are really useful because rather than putting all of the sensors on one robot, you can sort of distribute them around so that we could definitely shrink the robots. And then they can also cover a lot more area,
mm-hmm.
right? And so if you have like a huge building, rather than one robot having to fly, we could put like 10 or 15 robots and they could carry that out.
It's amazing. And you were saying that this one was built a bit to be like how a fly would get
yeah.
away from someone swatting it. Can you talk to me a bit about why that
sure.
was the design?
Yeah, so this was my Google Science Fair project a few years ago, and this was like one of the first steps towards this.
And so
right?
how old were you for the first one?
14.
14, and now he's 17. It's amazing.
Thanks. So basically the idea here is that like if we're trying to do one of those search and rescue missions that I talked
mm-hmm.
about, we're in these really dangerous environments, right?
Right.
So a ceiling could collapse, an object could fall,
mm-hmm.
and we really have to be able to deal with that within about half a second to continue
right.
on what we're doing. But drones suck at basically responding to different things like that. So they're really bad at flying in really dangerous
shifts
environments.
So immediate shifts in an
environment,
you mean? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, so if we, drones really work in very predictable environments,
mm-hmm.
But they're not really good at responding to like really dangerous, unpredictable environments.
Mm-hmm.
And so what I wanted to do was basically draw inspiration from the fruit fly's escape, because fruit flies, as we all know, are brilliant at escaping. And so draw inspiration from that escape to basically build some instinct into these flying robots to make them better at working in these really dangerous real-world environments. And so that was my Google Science Fair project. And since then, I've been looking at creating some different core capabilities. So that's one core capability, right? Being
mm-hmm.
able to escape from stuff. I've been also working on creating algorithms, again, based on biology,
mm-hmm.
that can help a drone avoid static obstacles. So things like tables and walls and chairs. And then also, you know, find things, right? So that's
mm-hmm.
One of the most important things that this drone has to do is find people or find different fires, or find fires, stuff like that. And so using some sensors and some intelligent algorithms to be able to actually do that. And then one of the most recent things I did over the past summer at MIT was basically creating an algorithm that could teach a flying robot how to fly,
mm-hmm.
just like people learn how to walk.
Amazing.
And so the idea is like if we're trying to fly in an environment with a lot of smoke
mm-hmm.
or with a lot of wind, stuff that could knock the robot off course, it's really hard to control the robot, right? And so if the robot can actually learn how to control itself, then that's, you know, that makes it a lot easier.
And so you view this self-learning as maybe mm-hmm. the next generation of this?
For sure, yeah. So I think autonomy and sort of machine learning and self-learning robot or drones are the future.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of drones on the market today are obviously like remote control drones, right?
Right.
And so you really need like a skilled pilot who's constantly telling them where to go.
Right.
And at least from personal experience, I think piloting these things is really hard.
Okay.
And so, you know, trying to build some autonomy into them and also trying to teach them how to, you know, control themselves, so trying to build that learning in
mm-hmm.
is really helpful as well.
And so you talked about building algorithms that mimic biology.
Mm-hmm.
So it sounds like biomimicry is playing a role. Can you talk to me a bit about biomimicry for people who might not know
yeah.
what it is and the principles?
Sure. So biomimicry is basically looking at biology for inspiration to solve some engineering challenges.
Mm-hmm.
And so the reason it's really useful here is because over millions of years, nature has you know, through evolution, basically optimized all of these kinds of things, right? So the fruit flies escape, for example. Fruit flies actually use this really cool escape behavior. So there's this lab at Caltech that basically found that whenever they're escaping, they first jump to the side using their legs, and then they use their wings to move vertically. And so that behavior has been sort of tuned over millions of years of evolution to be basically perfect, right? And so by looking to biology for inspiration when designing these drones, we can cut out a lot of the R&D work. Right. So nature has already done a lot of that testing and
already
development.
Already tested and become better over time. It's amazing. And so talk to me a bit more about the functionality of this and the specifics of the technology that you have embedded here. I think people are probably curious, like, what exactly is the technology in here?
Sure. So first, so basically my research over the past few years in science fairs and in university labs focused on building these four core capabilities out. So I talked about this one is like avoiding moving threats. So avoiding things like collapsing ceilings, falling objects. I also worked on in a lab at Carnegie Mellon, which is close to where I live in Pittsburgh, on avoiding static obstacles. So that's the second thing. The third thing is finding stuff. And the fourth thing is teaching a robot how to fly. And so those are some of the capabilities. And so what I'm trying to do now is combine those puzzle pieces, right? So those different pieces of the puzzle, trying to combine those to create this robot. And so the idea is
Am I looking at right here?
So this I built this robot from scratch. And the idea is that it has some basic, pretty low-cost base hardware. And so that's, motors and, different components like that. And then you could plug in different sensor modules based on whatever task you're trying to accomplish. So a first responder, if they're trying to find people, they plug in a thermal camera. If they're trying to find a gas leak, they plug in a gas sensor, right? And then the robot can intelligently use some of those algorithms that I developed to be able to carry out that mission autonomously.
And when you were creating this, what was your inspiration behind this idea?
So it's actually a funny story. So the way I started was through that, looking at fruit flies. And so a few years ago, my family went on vacation to India. And when we got back, we realized that we left some bananas on our kitchen counter. And so our house was filled with fruit flies when we got back. And so I just kept trying to swat them, and I got really mad when they kept escaping. But I also started to become really curious about, like, how can fruit flies escape so well, right? Like, they're really tiny creatures. They have really small brains. They have awful vision. So what could they possibly be doing to escape? And so I did some research. I Googled a lot, found some papers online. And basically, the key to the fruit flies' escape is the fact that they have really bad eyesight. So their eyes, they can't see in very much detail at all. But that means that they can, that means they can process whatever they can see and react to that really quickly. So they can actually see 10 times faster than we can. And that's what enables them to escape so effectively. And so around the same time, I had started reading about drones. And so I realized that drones have tremendous potential to help out in those kind of applications I talked about, so search and rescue and things like that. But they were really terrible at dealing with unpredictable environments. And so I wanted to see whether we could sort of mimic what I learned about the fruit flies escape to make drones better. And then after that initial project, seeing it work really well, I got really curious about how else we could draw from biology to make drones better. Because as I said, biomimicry, I think, is a really cool approach to engineering that can help us cut out a lot of the design time when sort of building these products. And so now, basically trying to combine all that research to create a product that can actually, help save lives.
It's amazing.
Thanks, yeah.
And yeah, so you started tinkering with robotics at the age of 10. What sparked that?
So when I was really little, so probably like 2 or 3, I had a robotic dog. And so that was my pet, because I didn't have a real dog, so that was my pet.
A robotic dog that you built, or that someone gave you?
Someone gave me. I was two.
So. Oh, you're two.
I would play with that all the time, and I thought it was really fascinating how, electronics and, some hardware and software could literally bring something to life. And so, I'd love to play with that, and that sort of sparked my interest in robotics and computer science. And so I remember one of my first projects, stuff that I built when I was 10. So I was in my middle school orchestra, and I'd play violin. I'd always play out of tune because I didn't know how to tune my violin. And so my teacher would always yell at me for, like, playing badly. And so what I did, I basically created a robot that could tune my violin for me. And so you'd play it, and it would analyze, the sound, determine how out of tune the violin was. And then it would use some motors to, like, turn the fine tuners to put it in tune. And so basically working on a lot of cool projects like that, and realizing that robotics is a really powerful way. So hardware, combining hardware and software at that intersection is sort of a really powerful way to help solve a lot of problems.
And it seems like you're just very naturally curious in this area. Have you just always felt that way?
I think part of it is my parents, right? They always inspired me to try to wonder how things work. So, seeing the fruit flies in my kitchen, seeing them escape, sort of sparked that question, how do they do it?
A lot of people would see fruit flies and just think, oh, how do I kill these things? But for you thought, oh, fruit flies, what makes these unique? Why can't I catch them?
Yeah, so definitely really curious, and I think curiosity is a great skill for inventors, because it lets you find inspiration a lot of places that you might not look. So you know, if I had started the other way, trying to build an escape algorithm for these drones, I would have I wouldn't know where to start, right? But looking at fruit flies and getting sort of inspired by them, sort of gave me a really good place to look for inspiration.
Yeah, and so you're 17. Mm-hmm. Technology is rapidly maturing and accelerating. There's new emerging technologies quite often. How do you think current technology is going to impact the generation even below you?
Sure. So I think it's becoming increasingly important for people in all kinds of fields to know how to use and build technology. So for example, things like law, medicine, finance, they're all being transformed by computer science and robotics. Mm-hmm. And so I think the really cool thing about growing up with technology is that first, it makes us really good at working with it. And I think, personally, growing up with technology has sort of helped me learn how to build it, right? And so it's...
You didn't have to backtrack at all.
Exactly, yeah. So, growing up with that robotic dog toy sort of showed me what's possible, so it gave me that initial inspiration. So I think that, going forward, it's really important to be able to, for people in all kinds of fields, mm-hmm. to have those technology skills, to not only be able to work with technology, but actually to build it. And so I think, for kids growing up with technology, the cool thing is that they're already there, because it's all around them.
Yeah. And are there any other projects that you're also working on right now?
Yeah, so this is my main project right now. Mm-hmm. And so mainly working on trying to see whether I can actually make this into a product that can be used in the field. I'm also working at a startup this summer. So back where I live in Pittsburgh, they basically make autonomous drones for construction sites. Okay. So the idea is like analyzing piles of dirt and trying to find volume and stuff like that.
We covered that technology recently.
Yeah. So that is, I think construction is one field that's mm-hmm. going to be transformed by robotics and specifically by drones.
Yeah.
And so that, I'm working as part of a bigger team there, obviously. But I think it's a really cool experience to work in a small company. It's around 30 people. And so to be able to work in that environment is really cool. And then I've also worked on a bunch of projects in the past that mm-hmm. I really love. So recently, for example, I built something called Heads Up. And so the idea is like in youth sports, for example, there's this concussion problem.
Definitely.
Where a lot of players are getting concussions and either coaches don't know how to diagnose those. So they mm-hmm. don't know that the players have concussions, or they try to push them back in the game because they think it's no big deal.
Right.
Right. And so to actually, diagnose the concussions, the reason that they don't get diagnosed is because it's a really long process. So mm-hmm. a player has to be taken out of play, sent to a hospital, and a doctor actually has to do some tests and diagnose them. And so with some friends at a hackathon, I developed this device, it's around $50, and it basically uses some eye tracking technology mm-hmm. To determine whether people have concussions using this 30-second test.
Wow.
And so the idea there is like whenever doctors are testing for concussions, they move their finger in front of your eyes.
Right, and they look for the pupil dilation and all of that.
Yeah, so they actually, the main thing they're looking for is whether your eyes are pointing in the same place at the same time.
Okay.
Right? And so if they're not, if one eye is slower than the other, that's a sign of a concussion. Right? And so using some eye tracking technology, so basically, we built this headset, mm-hmm. and it would flash a pattern on some LEDs, on some lights around the mm-hmm. device, and then it would see how your eyes track that to determine whether or not you have a concussion. So it's this really cheap, easy way to test for that. So that's one project that I worked on. Another project that I really that I worked on in the past that I really like is called TMA Scan. And so it's basically a set of image processing algorithms that can help doctors diagnose brain tumors. And so the idea is like whenever doctors are, the way doctors currently diagnose them is by looking at these huge images. Mm-hmm. And they basically have to pore through them over and over again of tissue sample images of tissue samples to determine whether there's a tumor and how bad that tumor is. And so trying to automate that process to make it a lot more subjective and also a lot faster, so they don't have to do that manually because we can write programs to do that for them. And so actually I had an opportunity to co-author a paper with some doctors who use my work to sort of get experimental results for pediatric brain tumors.
Incredible.
Thanks.
And so you've already done so much at your young age. You're starting at Stanford in a month. Congratulations.
Thanks. Yeah, I'm super excited.
You should be. And do you have, a dream of where you see yourself in 10 years?
Sure. So I definitely want to start a company in the future. I think specifically companies that are focusing on solving really hard problems.
Yeah.
So taking, commercializing research, right? So taking mm-hmm. Some new science that's actually pushing the boundaries and trying to build that into a product is really exciting. So hopefully in sooner than 10 years, maybe 5 years, working on some projects to actually, start companies around some really hard technical problems. And so I think that's really cool. I think that can be really impactful.
Amazing. Well, thank you so much for being here today. And I am just absolutely excited for your future.